It seems like everywhere we go in surface metrology these days, we're hearing about gear noise. You see what I did there? Hearing about gear noise? Yeah, right. Bad joke. Well, let's take a look at a surface that might have some gear noise associated with it. I'm going to drag in a measured data set from a helical gear tooth. So we'll go to the raw data just so you can see that I'm not playing any tricks here. I have no settings turned on. We're going to start from scratch and walk our way through how we might analyze this surface. Well, the first thing I would do to analyze this surface is crop away the tip of the gear tooth and zoom in kind of on the zone that we care about. So let's rotate this a little bit, maybe 8 degrees. Yeah, that's pretty good. Possibly 8.1 degrees if we wanted to be really crazy. And we can now put a rectangular selection zone on this area and analyze that now as our pre-processed surface. Now, once we've cropped the surface, we've gone from raw data to pre-processed data. There's some other pre-processing things we could do. For example, let's fill those holes. I'm going to fill those missing pixels with a bicubic interpolation, and now they go away. That's nice. And our next move would be to level this surface. So we'll go to a geometry and put a plane geometry into the surface. And we go from preset processed to that plus geometry. We now see how the plane fits through this surface. And if we level that plane, going to form removed now, we can see the geometry of the gear tooth. Now we want to get rid of this geometry so we can see the waves in the surface, if indeed there is a gear tooth waviness problem. So instead of the plane, let's choose a fourth order polynomial. And I'm going to choose fourth order in the x direction and in the y direction. When we do this, the geometry that we fit through the surface follows much better. And when we subtract it away, we get this more flattened view of the data. Now here it becomes apparent that there might be some optical problems, perhaps with steep slopes, maybe some dirt on the surface, and we want to do some cleaning. So I'm going to go back to the analysis settings, and we're going to use a robust short filter for this. Now, we know our pixels are probably on the order of a micron or so, so let's try an 8-micron short filter and apply that. When we apply that short filter, we've now moved from form removed into the primary surface. And yes, it's done its job quite nicely. We can see that those spikes are eliminated. And let's improve life here by zooming in a bit on the scale and taking a look at our surface. Yes, that's looking great, but we do indeed see that there's kind of a wave going on in this surface. And as this gear tooth meshes with its neighbor, it's going to potentially cause noise. So it would be good to be able to explain this waviness and put a number to that where we can put tolerances and controls on it. So let's first try to come up with a way of extracting the wave out of the roughness. The way we do that was with filtering, and I'm going to use a long filter for this now. Now, typically in profile analysis, we might find the Gaussian filter. I'm going to use a second order Gaussian filter. This is a Gaussian filter that has better performance with curves near the edges of the surface. And typical filtering is with a 0.8 millimeters, that millimeter filter cutoff. That's common in most profile analysis, so let's start there. And we are getting through our filtering, and we now have this primary surface. Let's insert our new waviness into that surface and look at primary and waviness. And we see that the 0.8 millimeter filter created this waviness surface. I'm not super happy with that because it doesn't follow the humps and bumps that I think are interesting. So if I go back to the filtering, and instead of the big 0.8 stiff filter, we're going to use a 0.25 less stiff or more conformable filter. So 0.25 millimeter cutoff will look something like this, and that looks fantastic. We can see that the filtered waviness surface follows the shapes that I'm interested in. We can see it down this side as I spin around. The second order Gaussian does a very nice job of following the edge effects of our surface. So that's terrific. That gives us a great view potentially of the waviness in this surface. We can take another peek at that by opening another window in OmniSurf 3D and push waviness over here. And with this chain link, we can sync them or unsync the two. And as I zoom one, we zoom them both and see that indeed this waviness that I'm showing transparent on the left seems to produce a shape over here on the right that could cause concern for noise. As this gear tooth meshes with the compatible tooth on the other side of the train, these bumps may cause two incidences per tooth that could cause noise. So this waviness is quite interesting, and it's a fascinating surface that we can see that hiding inside our roughness. Now, I mentioned roughness here to say that if I take that waviness away, we are left with our filtered surface, or what we might consider roughness. We're looking at a band of waves from 8 microns up to 0.25 millimeters, and we can do our normal roughness kinds of things and look at an SK or an SA or maybe an SQ, whatever your parameters are of interest, and do a typical roughness analysis on this filtered surface. In the world of 3D surface texture, we typically work on one wavelength domain at a time. So right now, this is a roughness domain, 8 microns to 0.25 millimeters, and these parameters are being calculated. But let's step back to where we were with our waviness conversation. Waviness is the longer wavelength realm for this surface. So to put numbers on waviness, we need to set the long wavelength realm for those parameters. Another way of looking at this might be to slice through this surface and look at the wavelengths of interest. This surface has a lot of different wavelengths in it, and currently we are looking at this band from short up to this long limit as kind of a band of interest for these parameters. For waviness, though, we want to look at the longer wavelengths, wavelengths that are beyond that 0.25 millimeters. So let's switch our filtering around now to look at waviness as our filtered surface. We'll go to filtering, and we see now we were set at 8 microns up to 2.5 millimeters. Let's move this over and go 2.5 millimeters and beyond. So all wavelengths longer than 2.5 millimeters are waviness, and now our filtered surface becomes this wavy surface. Now, for waviness, we might use different parameters. The most common parameter people might look at would be the ST parameter, the total height of this surface. The total height of this surface is from this corner to perhaps this corner over here. Two points are being used out of the millions of points we may have measured. ST is the highest point to the lowest point, and in this case, in the context of gear noise, it's probably meaningless. In fact, I've looked at a lot of other surfaces, and the total peak to valley does not correlate to gear tooth noise. The thing that's making noise are these bumps and ridges in the middle of the data, not the edges. And for that reason, OmniSurf 3D has some better parameters. Let's look at the STC parameter. STC is a parameter unique to OmniSurf 3D. It's like ST, it's the total peak to valley, but it's for the contained peaks and valleys. It's the features that live inside the surface, not out at the edges. So if we look at STC, I'm going to add that to my output, and we'll crunch through that one. We see that it's a much smaller number. It's only 0.27 micrometers, but it's a much more meaningful number. It relates to the peaks and the pits and the valleys and the ridges that are in the middle of the surface, in the middle of that mesh of the gear teeth. We can actually take this one step further. We can look at STC along the X direction and the Y direction. And this might be important as functions apply along the axial or root to tip direction of a gear tooth. In this case, we see STC along the Y direction is much higher than that along the X direction. Well, that's the case here, that if I look along the Y direction and find local peaks and valleys along every possible line of the Y direction, those errors are higher than if I were to look along the X direction. Along the X direction, this line is relatively straight, but along the Y direction, I see more errors. So STC is a much more powerful parameter for gear noise, and if we look at it along the X or Y direction, perhaps we can see influences of the manufacturing process and the function. So all of that said, here's kind of a step-by-step tour of how we might analyze a gear tooth surface, starting out from the raw measured data all the way through the cropping and the analysis of our gear tooth. So hopefully this was helpful to give you a bit of an idea of how we might explore a noisy gear, and better yet, how we might be able to put numbers on those errors that you can tolerance and you can control. To find out more, be sure to reach out to us at digitalmetrology.com. We're glad to help, and we love talking about this stuff.